Here's your daily announcer. I have serious news to pass on to everybody.
What I'm about to say could mean the world's disaster, could change joy and laughter to tears and pain. It's that love's in need of love today. Don't delay, send yours in right away. Hate's going round, breaking many hearts. Stop it, please, before it's gone too far. The force of evil make you its possession, and it will, if you let it, destroy everybody. We all must take precautionary measures. If love and peace you treasure, then you'll hear me when I say,
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you. Good morning. Welcome to the First Unitarian Church of Hamilton. We welcome those in the sanctuary this morning and those who have opted to join us on Zoom with their house slippers or perhaps unclad feet entirely. My name is Beverly Horton and I am this morning's service leader. I want to thank today's service team, which includes, as our music ministers this morning, we have DJ Moons on piano and Joanne Deere will be leading a hymn for us this morning. You've just heard a recording from the Berklee Artist Relief Ensemble from Berklee College of Music. And at the end of the service, there will be a recording of BIPOC Virtual Ensemble that was from this year's UUA General Assembly. Our tech team this morning includes Bruce McPherson, Josh McIntyre, Marianne Forbes, and John Elliott. And our ushers this morning are Karen Moore and Paula Bourne. Our speaker this morning is Donovan Hayden. And for those of you who've been around the congregation for a while, you'll know that he is the son of one of our recent intern ministers, Pat Trudeau. Donovan is a Black activist and theater creator. Last year, he finished an MA in theater and performance studies at York University in Toronto. He's an organizer for the political nonprofit Progress Toronto, and he's had the opportunity to engage with Unitarians and anti-racism work in both Canada and the US. Donovan's work blends activism and art for the goal of liberation and the dismantling of white supremacy. Online folks are muted, and I'd ask that those in person follow same. Mute yourselves and your devices. Today's service is live streamed from our church here in Hamilton, which is on the sacred lands of many peoples. We live on the traditional territories of the Erie, Neutral, Huron-Wendat, Haudenosaunee, and Mississaugas. This land is covered by the Dish with One Spoon Wampum Belt Covenant, which was an agreement between the Haudenosaunee and Anishinaabe to share and care for the resources around the Great Lakes. By making this acknowledgement, may we commit to learn Indigenous history and practices, honor Indigenous self-determination, and fight to dismantle settler colonialism on this land. May we all be good ancestors. We welcome you today, whatever the circumstances of your life, in the many ways we identify as people and in the diversity of how we love and live. In this house of faith, we are included as we all search for truth, as we build community, and as we strive to make the world a better place for all. Our call to worship is an excerpt from Donovan Hayden's play, X and the Spirit. Donovan, if you join me.
It is messy, chaotic, susceptible to fits of passion. It does not promise peace. It does not promise security.
It certainly does not promise security. It exposes the fragility of the concepts. It is dependent on others, yet it is inevitable.
The people's resistance, defiance, courage, give it energy. It returns that energy to the people through churches, scholars,
language,
dance,
the land,
art.
It is perpetually locked in conflict with a powerful foe, but has the tenacity to say,
we will win.
It is a release.
It is hope.
It has created families of strangers. It speaks in a language known but unspoken.
I can hear it. I don't know how, but I can. It is trying to teach.
Inspire.
Activate the spirit of the struggle.
Our chalice represents the light of hope at the center of our faith tradition. The spark of this flame draws us into our time of worship and community. Donovan, would you care to join me and light the chalice, please? Please join me in the chalice lighting words. May this flame be our light of friendship and love.
Good morning. Our time for All Ages this morning is written by Amanda Gorman, American poet and activist, and who was the National Youth Poet Laureate from 2017-2018. On January 2nd, 2021, Gorman became the youngest poet to read at a presidential inauguration in United States history. Gorman has stated that she intends to run for president in 2036. Let's hope so. And commented in a 2018 interview, "Seeing the ways that I as a young black woman can inspire people is something I want to continue in politics. I don't want to just speak works. I want to turn them into realities and actions." And the piece we're reading today is called Change Sings, a children's anthem written by Amanda Gorman, and pictures by Lauren Long. Just waiting for the video to catch up. I can hear change humming in its loudest, proudest song. I don't fear change coming, and so I sing along. I scream with the skies of red and blue streamers. I dream with the cries of tried and true dreamers. I'm a chant that rises and rings. There is hope where my change sings. Though some don't understand it, these windmills of mysteries, I sing with all the planet and its hills of histories. I hum with 100 hearts, each of us lifting a hand. I use my strengths and my smarts, take a knee to make a stand. I'm bright as the light each day brings. There is love where my change sings. I show others tolerance, though it might take some courage. I don't make a taller fence, but fight to build a better bridge. I talk not only of distances, from where and how we came. I also walk our differences to show we are the same. I'm a movement that roars and springs. There's a wave where my change sings. Change sings where? There, inside me, because I'm the change I want to see. As it grows like seeds. I am just what the world needs. I'm the voice where freedom rings. You're the love your bright heart brings. We are the waves starting to spring, for we are the change we sing. We're what the world is becoming, and we know it won't be long. We all hear change strumming. Won't you sing along? And that's the end of our time for all ages today. And Max, if you want to join Petra and I, we're going to go have some fun with the children's program.
As you go, may joy surround you. As you go, go in peace. Know our love is with you always. As you go, as you go. In the free faith tradition, we are the support and resources of this congregation. Our gifts and donations sustain the many ministries of this church, a community we have chosen to join and to support. We will now receive our offering while DJ plays for us. Your gifts in support of our ministries to one another and to the community are greatly appreciated. Thank you. In these moments of contemplation, I invite you to relax, close your eyes, if you like, and breathe deeply. Following our reading, there will be a few moments of silence followed by a very brief chant. This morning's reading is entitled, Pry Me Off Dead Center. It's from a collection called Gorillas of Grace by Ted Loader. O persistent God, deliver me from assuming your mercy is gentle. Pressure me that I may grow more human, not through the lessening of my struggles, but through an expansion of them. Deepen my hurt until I learn to share it and myself openly and my needs honestly. Sharpen my fears until I name them and release the power I have locked in them and they in me. Accentuate my confusion until I shed those grandiose expectations that divert me from the small, glad gifts of the now and the here and the me. Expose my shame where it shivers, crouch behind the curtains of propriety until I can laugh at last through my common frailties and failures, laugh my way toward becoming whole. Deliver me from just going through the motions and wasting everything I have, which is today a chance, a choice, my creativity, your call. O persistent God, let how much it all matters pry me off dead center. So if I am moved inside to tears or sighs or screams or smiles or dreams, they will be real and I will be in touch with who I am and who you are and who we are, my sisters, my brothers, my siblings, all. We're finding our way to be who we need to be. We're finding our way to be who we need to be. Finding our way, finding our way, finding our way. We're finding our way to be who we need to be. We're finding our way to be who we need to be. Finding our way, finding our way, finding our way, finding our way.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Before I begin, I just want to say that this moment feels very special to me. I have given this talk many times, most times on Zoom, sitting in my room, and usually wearing pants or at least pajamas or something. But this will actually be my final talk for a little while as I focus more on theater and more on organizing. But I'm so happy to be here in this space, in person with all of y'all today, to be in a church that was so pivotal in my mother's journey as a minister, and of course to be with the great Beverly Horton, who inspired, and really more than inspired, is the reason why I am here speaking and why this is even a discussion in this country. I used to be a member of the EMC Greater Fellowship. That stood for Easter, Mother's Day, and Christmas, as those were the only times I actually could be bothered to come into a Unitarian service. As the son of a minister, that may be surprising to many of you, but like many Unitarians, during my teenage years, I stopped coming and stopped identifying myself as a Unitarian. Sometimes with the occasional service, I would attend UU summer camps, but even my participation in those began to fade. Besides, through my parents, I had no real investment in this community or calling myself a Unitarian Universalist. It was not until the summer of 2020, roughly 5 years disconnected from the faith, that I began to reconnect with it. It was after being invited to speak at the First Church of Pittsburgh by Reverend Connie Grant due to my involvement in the protests after George Floyd's murder. I had spoken at UU churches before, including this one, but it was always through invitation of my parents. But to be sought out for my own work felt really good. I accepted and gave my first version of anti-racism as a spiritual practice. That was in July 2020, and little did I know that I would go on to give that same talk at 22 more congregations on Zoom, in person, in the US and in Canada, and then go on to give this talk in many other congregations. As I spoke, I researched more about UU's commitment to anti-racism, and of course, this eighth principle. It is because of this engagement with social justice, anti-racism work, and the valuing of experiences of Black people that I was brought back into the faith and proudly call myself a Unitarian Universalist today. I was excited about the eighth principle and to hear that the CUC was looking to adopt it at a special meeting, and they did it last year in November. After two difficult hours, the eighth principle was passed. However, I did not feel the joy that I had expected. When I connected with other racialized UUs, including Beverly, there was a feeling of being wary and weary. The first hindrance to our joy is that we saw how the sausage got made. We were involved in this process very deeply and often were challenged and sometimes inspired by it. Secondly, we knew we had work to do. After the vote passed, we seemed to all be in agreement. Today we celebrate, but tomorrow we work. This time, the work does not need to fall solely on racialized people and our few allies. Now that the CUC and many congregations have adopted the eighth principle, it calls all Unitarians to individual and communal action that accountably dismantles racism and other systemic barriers to full inclusion in ourselves and in our institutions. It is time to put the eighth principle into action by shifting our priority from diversity to anti-racism, cultivating external relationships outside these walls, and reckoning with the internal racism that was exposed during the Eighth Principle process. Diversity to anti-racism. Like many liberal spaces, UU congregations are focused on diversity. A common question I got after my talk was, how do we attract more Black and racialized people into our congregations? Often paired with, our congregation is predominantly older and white, what are we supposed to do? I appreciated these questions and recognized the difficulty that many congregations face when trying to be diverse. The reality is that our congregations are predominantly white, and most of them are situated in predominantly white communities. It is important that we seek efforts to diversify our churches, but it is almost an impossible task for many congregations. Even when diversity initiatives are done successfully and people are brought in, they do not equate to anti-racism work. What good is seeking diversity when all we do is expose racialized people to racism that has remained dormant in our congregations? I believe that Canadian UUs can better use their resources to prioritize being anti-racist. This does not mean that we ignore diversity, but recognize that with or without racialized people in the room, we have work to do as well. With all that is going on, it may feel overwhelming to take on another fight or to be asked to do another struggle or journey on into something. However, it is important that we remember that many of our modern crises are a result of white supremacy. And if they are not a direct result, we know who faces the real consequences of many of these crises. That is why, more than ever, it is so important that we take real action and not just be concerned with optics. In 2015, white anti-racism activist Chris Crass made this observation at the UUA General Assembly. Quote, "The question for us as Unitarian Universalists is not how many people of color we can get into our pews, it's how much damage that we can do to white supremacy." End quote. White supremacy was created and is sustained by white people. Therefore, white people, y'all are obligated to dismantle it. For example, after the Attorney General decided to not indict the cops who killed Breonna Taylor while she was sleeping at her home, the First Unitarian Church of Louisville opened their doors to keep protesters safe from the police after an imposed curfew. Reverend Lori Kyle, who did some of her ministry in the Greater Toronto Area, was one of the leaders of that church as it became a pivotal hub for folks who were on the front lines. It became a saving grace. The church was criticized and under heavy police surveillance and intimidation, but they kept providing support every night. This was not intended to diversify the church, but instead to do their part to dismantle racism and, more importantly, support those who were really taking it to the streets. I am sure that many congregants at First Louisville were uneasy and maybe even scared to involve themselves in the chaos and violence of what was happening out in the streets. But as one congregant professed, quote, "Every time we offer a bottle of water, God is there. Every time we offer comfort, God is there." End quote. We may not find God in anti-racism work, but we can find inspiration, love, and spiritual depth that will dismantle racist systems and create the positive change in the world that I know we all want. Building external relationships. UUs can put the eighth principle into action by engaging with individuals and groups external to ourselves, outside of these walls. It is important that, like First Church Louisville, we support the movement with more than just words and prayer. As prominent Black UU Ken Wiley said, quote, "Protests need food and water. Movements cost money. Events need set up and take down help. And meetings need physical spaces." Or in some cases, a premium Zoom account. That part was not a quote. I added that. Many of our congregations have access to space, money, and networks of people that we can mobilize to support them. However, support is almost impossible if we don't know who we're supporting. It requires engagement. The reality is that organizationally, Unitarians do not have a relationship to today's struggle for racial justice. It hurts me when I connect with activists and organizers who have worked with the United Church or the Anglican Church, but don't even know what a Unitarian is. There are many UUs and UU groups that are doing the work, but much of our collective action has been misplaced and unreliable. While we sat and debated the eighth principle, Black youth took to the streets to demand the defunding of the police. While we worried about procedure, Indigenous land defenders put their bodies on the line to stop the destruction of our natural habitats. Some congregations were wordsmithing, while unhoused people resisted being violently evicted from their homes and encampments. I valued the discussion on the eighth principle and was pleased to be a part of it. It was a big step for Canadian UUs, and it did require discussion. However, we have fallen behind. Now that the eighth principle has passed, it is time to catch up. Unitarians, especially white Unitarians with privilege, should find ways to get engaged, but also approach as humble followers or visitors. After attending the protest in Ferguson following the murder of Mike Brown, interfaith pastor and civil rights activist Osagyefu Sekou said in an interview, quote, "The leadership that is emerging are the folks who have been in the streets, who have been tear gassed. The leadership is Black, poor, queer, women. It presents in a different way. I am not a leader in this movement. I am a follower. I take my orders from 23-year-old queer women." End quote. I am proud that UUs have a history of activism and of organizing. I am proud of the UUs that are leaders in movements for climate justice, LGBTQ rights, and the rights of folks living with disabilities, or maybe were involved in the civil rights movement. We need your experience, support, and presence. What we require now is that you let us take the lead, that you trust us and our vision for a just world. Reconciling with internal racism. In order to move forward in this struggle, we must reconcile our past. As I gave talks to many congregations about anti-racism, there seemed to be a sentiment that UUs have simply not been doing the work and now need to get re-involved. For the most part, I agree with that. Many UUs have good intentions and progressive ideals. I am affirmed by the white allies doing the work to educate themselves, urging others to take actions, and supporting those doing the work as well. Folks are at different stages And that is fine as long as we are all working together for a common goal. However, through my talks, I was also exposed to small pockets of Unitarians whose racist ideals and actions still take up space in our congregations. How can we as a faith move forward in dismantling racism without directly addressing our racist systems and actions? One does not need to go deep into the archives of UU history to find moments of racism and white supremacy. You need only ask racialized people or reflect on the Eighth Principle process. The Eighth Principle started many insightful conversations, inspired people to act, and changed minds. There are still those who remain opposed. The disruptive tactics at the special meeting in November and the online response after the principle was passed made clear that there was a loud minority that covers their racism with nice words, diversions, and concerns about timing. Throughout the Eighth Principle process, many harmful sentiments were shared by Unitarians. In the Dismantling Racism Study Group survey, scary remarks were given, such as, "While working with new cultures coming to our area, do not forget that we were here first, and our lives matter. We have welcomed others and helped them with handouts as well as hand ups, but at the displacement of our core traditions." This opinion is certainly extreme, but it is not uncommon. Many UUs have expressed this sentiment to me as well. Maybe not with such direct language, but still the same sentiment that discussions about racism and racialized people were taking up way too much space. My hope is that those individuals have educated themselves and grown. But I also suspect, and am often reminded, that many have not and will not budge. It is important that in any major decision in a group of people that there be differing opinions. But what is scary to me is how defiant the detractors are. The opinions may seem civil and harmless, and I can understand why many Unitarians would believe that. Although there is certainly no consensus amongst racialized UUs, one thing we can agree on is that this type of rhetoric is harmful. For example, after the CUC announced the passing of the Eighth Principle, an email was sent warning CUC leaders of moving in a critical race theory direction. For those who maybe are unfamiliar with that term, critical race theory was started as a legal doctrine and moved into education to look at the ways that racism intersects with all aspects of society. In recent years, the right wing has co-opted that term to be used as a way to play into conservative fears and the need to keep history white friendly. It is a term in this usage that has no space in Unitarian Universalism. Examples like this always remind me that for many, this is just a debate. But for us, it's a fight to have our existence recognized and respected. I have watched as racialized UUs gave eloquent and passionate testimonies on the Eighth Principle and its importance to them, based in data and lived experiences, only to be ignored or discredited. To the individuals who stand opposed to the Eighth Principle, even the ones who reluctantly support it but still have their concerns and will often voice that, I only have one message. It is not about you. It is about the indigenous people whose ancestors' removal allowed for our faith to grow on this land. It is about the black people who were abandoned by the UUA in the 1970s. It is about the racialized people who have tolerated relentless racism and resisted leaving after every time someone made them feel unwelcome and tokenized. Many of our fellow congregants have understood this or have learned this. So we must ask, what is holding some of us back? We have been understanding. We have been patient. But racialized people cannot tolerate more feet dragging and more harm. I know church to be a place to learn, grow, and heal. But that's not going to come at my expense. Every incident is different and situated in a different context. It requires a gracious and nuanced approach in a community. But it still needs to be addressed for what it is, racism, so that it does not happen again and again and again. Only after we call a moment or action racist can we actually begin to assess and heal. It is an exciting time to be a young black Unitarian. 2 years ago, I could never have imagined myself saying that in a stage, in a congregation, in a church. Honestly, it is an exciting time to be a Canadian UU, period. We have just begun a journey to dismantle racism and white supremacy, to make our congregations truly safe and inclusive places, to meet new and inspiring people that will lead and inspire us, to fight for the eighth principle has been tough, but it has also been exhilarating. Watching people's minds change and connecting with other committed UUs has been spiritually awakening. There are some who do not know which way the wind is blowing and will fight to undermine the great work. But as my precursors proclaimed, I ain't gonna let nobody turn me around. I'm going to keep on walking and keep on talking. Let us, as Unitarian Universalists, keep on walking, talking, and living the eighth principle. Thank you.
Thank you, Donovan. We're in good hands. I think we're in good hands. We're finding our way to be who we need to be. We're finding our way to be who we need to be. Finding our way. Finding a way, finding a way, finding a way. We're finding a way to be who we need to be. We're finding a way to be who we need to be. Finding a way, finding a way, finding a way, finding a way. Our benediction for this morning is an excerpt from The Call of Our Faith by Dr. Taqiya Noor Amin. Part of the call of our faith, the mandate of what it is to be a Unitarian Universalist, is to figure out how we live together in loving, equitable, just relationship with each other. The proof of our faith is the extent to which we do that. The proof of our faith is not in some confession that we make. The proof of our faith is not in some words that we say. The essence is our endeavor. The proof of what we believe is in how we do the work of bringing together love, justice, and community. May it be so.
One day, when the glory comes, it'll be ours, it'll be ours. Oh, one day, when the war is won, we will be sure, we will be sure. Oh, glory.
To the heavens, no one, no weapon formed against, yes, glory is destined. Everyday people and kin become legends. Sins that go against our skin become blessings. The movement is a rhythm to us. Freedom is like religion to us. Justice is juxtapositioning us. Justice for all, just ain't specific enough. One son died, his spirit is revisiting us. True and living, living in us. Resistance is us. That's why Rosa sat on a bus. That's why we go through America with our hands up. When we go down, we toughen ourselves up. They say stand down and we rise up. Stop, we on the ground, the camera pan up. King pointed to the mountaintop and we ran up.
One day, when the glory comes, it'll be ours, it'll be ours. Oh, one day, when the war is won, we will be sure, we will be sure. Oh, glory,
glory.
The torch, we gon' run with it now. Never look back, we done gone hundreds of miles. From dark roads, heroes, to become a hero. Facing the League of Justice, his power was with the people. Enemy is lethal, a king became regal. Saw the face of Jim Crow under a bald eagle. The biggest weapon is to stay peaceful. We sing, our music is the cuts that we bleed through. Somewhere in the dream we had an epiphany. Now, we right the wrongs in history. No one can win the war individually. It takes the wisdom of the elders and young people's energy. Welcome to the